Welcome to Engineering with Rosie. Lithium-ion batteries have been improving our lives since the 1990s, originally by making music players and mobile phones more portable, and over the last decade, improvements in cost and energy density have enabled the massive growth in electric vehicles that we're experiencing. And as costs decrease further, we're seeing them used more often in stationary applications like grid batteries. As we progress towards carbon neutrality, we're going to need many more EVs and more batteries to support the electricity grid. This projected growth has caused some to wonder whether we're going to have enough lithium to supply the rapidly growing battery industry. Then there is a question of the environmental impact of all this lithium mining and processing, in particular greenhouse gas emissions. The carbon footprint of its battery is by far the largest component of an electric vehicle's total lifetime emissions, and lithium makes up a really decent chunk of that. The total lifetime emissions of an electric vehicle is lower than an internal combustion car in all but the most extreme cases. But still, there has been much made of the fact that the upfront emissions of an EV are more than an equivalent ICE car. Are we going to be able to make a carbon neutral lithium ion battery anytime soon? To answer this question, at least the lithium part of the question, I got in touch with Alex Grant, who is a chemical engineer working in the lithium industry. I'm going to ask him whether we've got enough lithium to support all the EVs and grid batteries that we need to support the clean energy transition, and how we can do it in an environmentally sustainable way. So I am going to ask Alex to answer all about that. But first, I do have to raise one thing that has been really bothering me, and that is how fair it is that everyone is so focused on the environmental impact of green technologies like electric vehicles and lithium-ion batteries, much more so than any dirty technology. I mean, I never heard anybody talk about the environmental impact of lithium mining before it was going into batteries for electric cars. I mean, I just feel like we're adding these extra hurdles, demanding clean energy technologies be perfect, and handicapping them relative to fossil fuels. And that means we're delaying the adoption of these cleaner alternatives. So I thought Alex might have an opinion on this. It's a bit of a philosophical question, but Alex, like myself, actually have degrees in philosophy. So I want to know his take. Is it fair, the amount of extra effort that the clean energy technologies have to go to relative to the incumbents?
I don't know if it's fair to frame it as extra effort, because there are in fact a ton of low-hanging fruit for decarbonization and environmental impact mitigation in process and project development today. So I've worked with projects who have never asked how much diesel they would burn over 30 years, right? And just by asking how much diesel they expect to consume, they decide to totally uproot and change around their mine plan to burn 25 to 50% less. So I don't think that they have been asked to do something particularly, you know, out of the way or challenging in that respect. You know, they really are just fundamentally trying to align themselves with the kind of priorities of their customers, right? Like, their customers are making electric vehicles to decarbonize transport. And once an EV is running on low carbon power, like hydro or nuclear or solar or wind, the majority of the life cycle emissions of the vehicle is the battery, a large fraction of it. So I think that all those low-hanging fruit should be identified and picked, right?
Yeah, okay. I have to concede that is a decent point. We need to clean up the future technologies, not the ones that we're phasing out and so will cease to emit anyway. So back to the technical questions then. We're going to need a lot of lithium-ion batteries in the future. Do we actually have enough lithium to make all these batteries?
Well, I have good news, Rosemary. We in fact do. So, 2020's total lithium market was on the order of 300,000 tons per year of lithium carbonate equivalent, which is kind of units from the industry for quantifying quantities of lithium most common. And the market in 2030 is expected to be somewhere between 1.5 and 2.5 million tons of lithium carbonate equivalent per year. The ocean contains 1 trillion tons LCE. So
there's lithium in the oceans.
There's 0.2 ppm of lithium in the oceans. So That is 1 million times the annual consumption of lithium in 2030, which will be significantly more than it will be today. There literally is enough lithium to make all the batteries. There is no literal shortage of lithium. So that's fine. And that's just the ocean. There's plenty of higher grade lithium on the continents as well. That in the hundreds to thousands of ppm of lithium that is kind of still ahead of us to develop. There are a lot of lower grade resources and less pure resources and new types of resources that we haven't had to process historically. However, the industry is to some extent meeting the moment and figuring out how to make lithium chemicals from those new resources. So to answer your question very clearly, yes, there is indeed a large quantity of lithium. The question is not, do we have enough lithium to make all the batteries? The question is, how will we make that lithium? What will be the cost of making that lithium? What will be the environmental impacts of making that lithium?
All right, so there's clearly never going to be an actual literal lithium shortage. But high concentration lithium, like we're currently mining, that is in short supply. So now I want to hear from Alex about how easy it's going to be to decarbonize lithium mining, even as we move towards these lower quality resources. I think to start, it would be helpful to talk about what forms lithium is actually found on the Earth's surface and how it's extracted into the form that we need it to make batteries.
Yeah, so lithium can be found in three main families of resources. Hard rock pegmatite resources are kind of crystalline, most usually white, very solid materials that need to be broken up and dissolved to some extent to release lithium in order to make lithium chemicals. Sedimentary clay minerals, well, not all of them are clays, but they're all sedimentary deposited at least, look kind of more like dirt. And they can be dug up and put into water more easily. And lithium is released from those sedimentary minerals kind of with lower energy requirement than for hard rock minerals, which often require calcination or heating up to 1,000 degrees Celsius. And there are very large quantities of sedimentary minerals across the Western US and in Serbia and Chile and different places. But no lithium is made from them today. So there's still kind of a class of, future resources being developed. And then the third are brines. So a brine is the aqueous product of millions of years of rainwater washing over sedimentary clays and hard rock minerals to make a super high salt content water solution of salts that contains lithium. So those brines are producing large quantities of lithium chemicals globally in Chile, Argentina, a little bit in Bolivia, in China today. And there are a number of hard rock operations, mostly in Western Australia, some in China, a little bit in Africa, and a bunch of projects in development in North America and Europe as well that will produce lithium chemicals. So okay. those three kind of families of natural resources are all really quite different, and they're all processed quite differently.
All right, so that is three very different ways that we find lithium, and vastly different mining and processing needed for each. So which deposits and which mining processes have the highest emissions intensity? I want to know, where do the emissions come from within that? Is it actual chemical reactions, or is it electricity that's used? Is it transport? Is it high temperature heating? And how are these likely to change as we move to lower grade resources?
Depends very much on the specific process being used on the specific resource, right? So there is no CO2 intensity in making lithium chemicals. There are many. But in general, in relatively general terms, if you're comparing hard rock spodumene resources being processed using calcination and leaching using acid versus brine resources being processed using evaporation, well, high purity brines being processed using evaporation or direct lithium extraction, it is true in a general sense that with a hard rock mineral, the rock has to be mined. So today there is virtually no electric mining equipment available. It's being developed and it hopefully will exist in the next 5 or 10 years. But today that involves combustion of fossil fuels and, you know, combustion of diesel, kind of whether you like it or not. And then those hard rock minerals are often, they have to be crushed, first of all, and then they're usually calcined at a very high temperature, which in China involves the use of coal in some cases. Elsewhere will mostly involve the use of fossil methane or natural gas, as some people call it. So that's another major driver of CO2 emissions of processing mineral resources. So in hard rock mineral processes, there don't need to be significant direct emissions that are not fossil fuel related. So it's possible to decarbonize mining and transport. It's possible to decarbonize calcination, actually. So those things can theoretically be decarbonized. The embodied CO2 emissions of reagents can be decarbonized if supply chains are decarbonized, right? There are some hotspots of direct emissions. So if I'm using lime, slaked lime, for example, right? Calcium hydroxide is made from calcium oxide after reaction with water, and calcium oxide is made from calcium carbonate, which is calcined to liberate CO2 from the carbonate to make calcium oxide, right? So unless that CO2 is captured, that is a direct emission. So any project that's using lime has that direct emission in its supply chain. So you know, in general, processes that consume more energy, especially if it's coming from fossil fuels and more reagents, will typically have a higher CO2 intensity, and that drives up the kind of typical CO2 intensity of making lithium chemicals from hard rock to between 12 and 18 kilos of CO2 per kilo of lithium hydroxide monohydrate, for example. For brines, it's a bit of another story. So the lithium is already dissolved in a solution, so you don't need reagents to put it in solution. You don't need to mine anything. You just need to pump it out of the ground and put it in a pond or pump it through a tank. It is possible to consume a lot of energy and reagents in brine processing. It is not necessary all the time, though. But yeah, so brine resources typically produce lithium chemicals with around 5 to 10 kilos of CO2 per kilo of lithium hydroxide monohydrate. So kind of around half of the CO2 intensity of making it from minerals today. All of that's subject to change. Every single process and every single project and every single operation is different depending on the natural resource.
Okay, so looking forward, can we get the emissions intensity to zero?
Yeah, so how do you decarbonize lithium manufacturing, and how do you, you know, potentially get it to 0 kilos of CO2 per kilo of lithium hydroxide monohydrate? I mean, it's the same problem as decarbonization of all of industry, right? If you need power, if you need heat, if you need chemical reagents, you know, all of those things today are emissions intense. The problem is to decarbonize power, decarbonize mining, right? Build brand new mining truck and mining equipment products to be used in lithium and nickel and cobalt and graphite and, you know, all other mining industries, really. And to make deliberate technical decisions to favor decarbonization. Because usually decarbonizing a process is aligned with lowering costs. It's usually not the other way around. Mm-hmm. Operating costs, I should say. Usually higher capital expense, I'll admit.
Yeah, so it sounds like it's actually really similar to the, you know, the whole world's decarbonization challenge. It's really similar areas that you've got to decarbonize. And actually, I'm a bit more optimistic about it after talking to you, because it might be, yeah, it might require you to buy a lot of expensive new equipment up front, but it's obviously going to be possible to electrify or use green hydrogen for all of this mining equipment. It's just a matter of, you know, actually deciding to do it. And it doesn't sound like there's so much that really just can't be decarbonized at all. Have I interpreted that right as a non-chemist?
I think that's true. But what's special about lithium and other battery metals is that these industries are being built for the battery industry and for electric vehicles. So the value proposition in that industry to decarbonize is very high because that industry is being built to decarbonize transport, right? Mm. So that's not the case in other industries.
Yeah, so maybe I have it backwards when I say, you know, it's unfair that lithium has to, you know, play this green role in addition to, or in contrast to all the, you know, traditional engineering. Maybe it's really an opportunity that you've got the chance to figure out these processes that might cost a bit more now, and then once lithium mining has figured it out, then, you know, if it's cheaper, why wouldn't it spread everywhere and help decarbonize other things?
Yeah, you could think of lithium as kind of a beachhead for decarbonization of the rest of industry.
Thanks for that, Alex. What a great conversation. And you have actually changed my mind about the way that I was thinking about green lithium mining. Because, you know, it's very easy for greenies. And I mean, I consider myself a greenie. I'm not using that term as an insult. It's very easy for us greenies to say mining is bad, I oppose it. But the reality is that mining is needed for the clean energy transition. It's not just lithium, there's all the other battery minerals, including cobalt, nickel, it's iron ore to make steel for wind turbine towers, rare earth minerals for electric motors and generators. And based on what Alex has said, a lot of the challenges needed to decarbonize mining are not really huge technological breakthroughs. A large part of the problem can be solved by replacing diesel with electricity or green hydrogen or biofuels. So for me as an Australian, I see a huge opportunity here. We have the minerals, we have the mining industry, we have plenty of sun and wind to make renewable electricity and hydrogen cheaper than most places on Earth. I want to thank Alex for taking the time to chat about his expertise, and I want to thank my Patreon community, as always, for their help suggesting what questions I should ask. There were several other interesting questions from the Patreon group that Alex did answer, but I couldn't fit in this cut. So an example is how easy it's going to be to get lithium out of recycled batteries in the future. I have shared a longer cut of the interview, including that topic, with the Patreon community, and you can get access to that by joining us. By joining the Patreon community, you'd also be supporting the channel and get the opportunity to help shape the future of engineering with Rosie by suggesting topics and questions for future videos. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.